from the leader in television news, Gary Rodemeyer, Melissa Swan, and Chuck Taylor. This is Kentuckiana's News Channel, WHAS 11.
What do you think of this call?
Oh, man, I'm ready to get in now, to be honest.
Cheers. But that's what we're facing tonight as we try to dig out of a record-breaking snow.
Back to work, get it finished, and hopefully we can get open tomorrow and get some work done.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Gary Rodemeyer.
I'm Melissa Swan. Welcome to an extended Storm Team newscast.
Let's go first tonight to Chuck Taylor as we approach perhaps an all-time record low temperature in Louisville. Chuck?
Well, we've set a record again. Earlier this morning, it got down to 10 below. This evening, got down to 13 below, setting the record for today. Now, for tomorrow, I think there's a chance we could tie for the coldest temperature ever here in Louisville, and there's even a chance we could go lower than 20 below, making it an all-time record for the Louisville area. Well, around us, our storm team trackers are already reporting temperatures of 20 to 21 below. Just look at this. Over in the Knob, Steve Mangus has 20 below zero. Howard Hall in Clark County and Underwood has 20 below. Vine Grove, Debbie Estes has 21 below. In Paoli, it's 21 below. And in Shelbyville, it is 20 below. Now, we should come out of the deep freeze by tomorrow afternoon, but as it starts to warm up, we should see a little snow develop tomorrow afternoon and continue tomorrow night. I'll have the details on that and the icy weather in just a few minutes.
The ice and, of course, the snow is still a problem. While progress is being made on clearing some of the roadways, many remain covered tonight. And Governor Jones's order to stay off the highways remains in effect.
Down at City Hall, the snow and the cold, a big concern tonight. The News Channel's Brooke Willis joins us live from there with an update on both of these continuing weather problems. Brooke, how's it going?
Well, Gary, as you can see, it's just as busy as ever out here. The folks are very busy taking all kinds of calls. People still need rides to get to work. They need rides to get to their shelter. Some folks just simply need their prescriptions picked up and they can't get out to get them. Now, the folks here have been hard at work all day. They'll be working throughout the night, but at least they have one thing on their side. They are not out in the cold. And as we found out very quickly today, that is the last place anyone would want to be. It certainly looked cold out there, but what mattered most, it felt cold.
It's just really indescribable. I can't even begin to describe it.
The cold may be too tough to describe, but the Floyd sisters didn't have a tough time figuring out outdoors is not the place to be.
How does it feel to be out here?
I wish I was in the house right now.
This bus shelter was the closest thing to a house Vallejo Wilson could get to while he waited for a ride. He had everything covered up, but it was still cold.
I'm not used to it. I'm from California. I'm just waiting to get back.
In spite of it all, people headed outdoors to dig out, shoveling their way out of this mess. Bill Bissig and his son are clearing a path, hoping they can open up their business tomorrow.
Aren't your ears cold? They're very red.
Mine? Yeah. I don't feel them anymore, sir. We've only been out here for 10 minutes, so we're all right. But anyway.
Back to work.
Back to work, get it finished, and hopefully we can get open tomorrow and get some work done.
And as the sun went down in Kentuckiana, the temperatures went down even lower. But people still covered themselves up and came outside. Bill Donaldson walked to work tonight. And you know what? He said it wasn't that bad. What's your secret to staying warm?
Well, not coming out for one.
Well, that's about the best advice you can possibly give. Do not come outside. As you can see, this gentleman over here at the command center taking calls. They've been taking calls all day long. They expect to do it much of the night. We do want to give some advice they've asked us to pass along. Please, folks, if you have any questions about what roads are passable, how to get from here to the airport, don't call 911. They have had so many calls that are really non-emergency calls, and they're really concerned about folks who need a medical emergency and need to get through and could not possibly because folks are calling asking about road conditions and things like that. If you do have a question about that, call the folks here, 574-3900. They can answer your questions. If you need a ride into work in the morning, they'll set it up for you. They've got all kinds of volunteers offering offering help, and they do need some volunteers still, folks who have four-wheel drive cars. We were told earlier they could use some four-wheel drivers in Sellersburg, so that's one thing. If you have one of those vehicles, please call in. And as you can see, Gary and Melissa, it's going to be a long night here.
Very long night. And Brooke, truck. We were inconvenienced by all the snow. It was more of an inconvenience than anything else, but with these frigid temperatures, we're really going into a dangerous, dangerous emergency.
Yes.
From that command center there, are you getting the feeling that they are shifting to a different kind of emergency response?
At this point, the calls are still mainly folks needing rides to and from work, but I'm glad you pointed that out because it's another thing they did ask us to stress is please, please do stay out of the cold, because some of those people you saw in our interview took it rather lightly, but it can be very serious, and they're concerned that people may put themselves in a life-threatening situation if they don't take this weather, this storm, seriously. And they're also urging you, you've heard it a million times, but how about a million and one? Stay off the roads, okay?
All right. Thank you, Brooke Willis.
Well, the cold weather creates more problems for LG&E as it tries to get the power back onto all of its customers. The company says it now has about 8,000 customers without electricity because of the storm. That's down from 20,000 right after the snow blanketed the area. But Communication Director Paul Hagen shows how the cold can cause the equipment to snap, creating the potential for even more outages.
The cold poses a lot of problems. It's obviously difficult for our workers, given the cold temperatures. They've got to be careful. At the same time, metal contracts in the cold, so everything is stiff, everything is under some strain, and it just makes everything a little, a lot harder to go.
LG&E crews will be working all through this cold tonight and through the morning hours to try and restore power to everyone.
And even without the problems they're expecting tonight, LG&E has quite a problem on its hands. Crews have worked around the clock to handle the emergencies. And as Donna Lacey reports, so far, folks in the dark have stayed patient.
We're going to get part of it up and then get it on, but there's some back in here that we got more wires down that we still be working on.
Okay.
All right. LG&E worker Terry Cambron has been explaining his head off to customers. They want their power back. He wants to give it to them. But it's not easy.
Just hang on as long as best you can, and we'll be there when we get there. They're working on it, and everybody's working as hard as they can. As cold as it is, you can't do a whole lot.
A look at this really live wire lets you know what LG&E crews are dealing with. It caught on fire. Something else just about burned up? The company's overtime budget. It'll be in the tens of thousands of dollars.
Got the domino ready for you? That's way down the line. Right. Right.
But customers have appreciated their work, like Doris and John Eckerly. The Eckerlys practically moved in with their neighbors, the Eckerlys, after Doris and John's power went out.
Are you going to miss them?
we really do have a good time together, don't we?
All right.
After a day and a half, Doris and John's power is back on.
This time it's been remarkable. And in fact, I didn't think we'd have power until maybe Thursday or even Friday.
Now that the heat's on, their home must warm up, something Terry Cambron hopes to be able to do soon. Donna Lacey, Kentucky Anna's News Channel, WHAS 11.
Motorists who got stranded in the snow and left their cars on the interstate highways now have a deadline to move them or else, ready or not. Today, the state began towing cars that block highways, moving them from the traffic lanes to the shoulders. Now, if there isn't a shoulder close by, the wreckers will take your car off the interstate to the nearest exit. Your car will be parked on a side street or a parking lot near that exit. Remember, this policy only applies to cars that are left on interstate highways. Trying to tow all the cars and trucks by the deadline, 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, is difficult with so many cars and so few tow trucks.
He said they had a two-day wait on a wrecker, and they can't do that. I mean, I can't see how they can do it and don't even have a wrecker to get them.
Now, if you have a car stranded and you can't get it off the highway by 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, you may have to pay the wrecker for the towing of your car. Again, your car will be towed off to the shoulder or to the nearest exit ramp.
Many, many people are still snowbound tonight, most of them in their homes, many in shelters. But as Mark Hebert shows us, those who got stuck had to depend on someone else to get where they needed to go.
Persistence often pays off. For a long line of stranded motorists seeking vehicle freedom on Interstate 71. Most of them had been rescued last night and taken to Red Cross shelters by Kentuckiana volunteers.
They did a great job. They really did a real good job. A lot of people would have been real cold without them.
Sharon and others got rides back to their cars, plus a little extra help from another set of volunteers.
It was
it's very nice.
I'll tell you how nice they are. I was trying to give some money for gas to this man. He says, no. No, we're here to help you.
Makes you feel good. Feel like that there is hope for humanity.
Some four-wheel drive owners help nurses get to work.
Y'all work for Jewish.
Yes,
and
sir.
This guy can't pick you up.
Yes.
And he's a very nice guy, a very good driver.
Others had no business being on roads like this or falling victim to Mr. Below Zero. And you had to wonder about the picture takers and the Hawaiians. But at least they didn't get stuck. Today, anyway.
Now it's my turn. I'm returning to my station car, which I abandoned here on the side of the interstate at 4:30 yesterday morning. It's been sitting here ever since. We're going to try and get it out of here. Frankly, I'm not too hopeful. We'll let you know what happens. Mark Ebert for Kentuckiana's News Channel, WHAS 11.
And Mark did get his car out of that snow pile thanks to the work of another good Samaritan. Mark Foster pulled a reporter out with a four-wheel drive truck and a very strong chain.
Now, get ready for a contrast. While the roads on the Kentucky side of the river are in difficult and rough shape, it seems to be smooth sailing in Indiana. We headed up I-65 north of the river a bit earlier this evening, and this is what we found. You can actually see the pavement in Indiana in a lot of areas. The National Guard is working in southern Indiana as well, helping out things. They're doing a good job, but it certainly isn't as bad as some areas, and conditions even improve as you drive northbound. And take a look at Interstate 75 near Cincinnati. It's a familiar scene in the Ohio Valley, a winter gridlock on the highways there. Dozens of cars and tractor trailers are stranded in northern Kentucky. The governor also closed this interstate today, except for emergency vehicles. While the blocked highways have been keeping people at home for the past couple of days, many are stranded in the house or in the subdivision.
And a couple of days stuck inside will leave you with a lot of cabin fever. Tonight, our Ann Jewell shows us how people are coping with that.
Relax, put your feet up. Spend the night with Super Mario. That's one cure for cabin fever.
The night before it snowed there, we debated about whether to go to Florida or not, and I think now we kind of wish we would have.
There's Matt. Yeah.
Matthew has the right idea. This little swinger won't go stir crazy.
Yeah, because he doesn't really know what's going on. But us, we go a little crazy at times. We guitar each other. But you get over it. You have to get used to it.
Just have to get used to it. That familiar feeling. You're anxious to get out.
I would say just about every house, up and down through here, is probably just the same. Everybody's, staying inside. And I walked out on the street today, a couple times, and you'd see a few people out, but that's about it.
Snowbound and sick of it.
If I had a way, I'd be in Florida right now. Too cold here for me.
Too cold.
I haven't seen winter like this in a long time.
None of us have. And to tell you how the cold is affecting us, Ann was supposed to be reporting live for us tonight. Her cable snapped because of the cold, so we're having a lot of problems ourselves. If you've been stuck at home these past few days, chances are you've been without your newspaper. The Courier-Journal tells us on Monday, when the storm hit, they were able to deliver about 70% to 80% of the newspapers. Today, they didn't do as well. Only about 50% to 60% made them out, and tomorrow they're expecting about that same number. The New Albany Tribune says one-third of their papers were delivered today, and that should improve with better road conditions, as you can see across the river. As for mail delivery, that will depend on how many people can get to the post office. Postal officials in the area are asking people to clear paths so letter carriers can get to your mailbox.
Now, there is a long list of business and school closings tonight, and we'll have that for you coming up a bit later. We'll bring you all that as soon as we can. Also tonight, Bullitt County officials say that people in shelters in their county don't have to worry about their stranded cars being towed.
And in Oldham County, all their volunteer fire stations are open as emergency shelters. If you need emergency shelter in Oldham County, you can go to a volunteer fire department. Oldham County officials are also asking residents to refrain from making telephone calls. This is across the region because they're still having trouble with the lines. Here in Louisville, TARC buses begin running tomorrow morning at 5:30 on major routes, but be prepared for delays because of the roadways and buses possibly getting stuck. When we come back to this extended 11 o'clock newscast, more on the storm of 1994.
We will tell you how this record-breaking weather can't stop the natural course of life and birth. We're still up to our kneecaps in snow, depending upon where your kneecaps are, and that might have created time off for you for the past couple of days. But there is no time off for area hospitals. Alliant shifted into Operation Snow, a disaster plan designed to get medical personnel to work. It takes a lot of phone calls and long hours to coordinate all of the transportation.
It takes. We've got a command center, so to speak, here with, as you can see, staffed by 10 to 15 people, and we're taking phone calls around the clock, and we'll continue to keep running until we can call it all clear for the crisis.
Well, the hospitals say that one problem to solve is finding child care during the storm for hospital staff. The most crucial kind of child care during this snowstorm has been for children who are about to be born. Their scheduled arrival cares very little about the bad weather.
We learned that firsthand here at the News Channel when our boss's wife went into labor early this morning, and it gave us a unique perspective on life in a maternity ward during a winter storm. Welcome to the world, Haley Elizabeth. Your record chart will show you arrived weighing 7 pounds, 7.5 ounces. You are 20 inches long. And these are the other records your mom and dad will someday tell you about your arrival. 16 inches of snow on the ground. The temperatures dipped to a bitter cold far below zero.
There are many stories. We're calling her the blizzard baby, but she's only one of I don't know how many blizzard babies.
And for each of the blizzard babies, another story of how mom and dad braved the snow and the frosty air to get you here.
We did have one that delivered in the back of a truck, and then EMS delivered a couple on the way here, so we've had several.
Nurses and doctors, emergency workers, and kind volunteers overcame the frigid obstacles to help bring you into the world.
I walked to work.
You did?
Yes, it was about a mile.
That's really dedication.
Yes, it is.
This little girl's mom speaks no English, only Vietnamese. But her smile does not need translation.
Lee Hung Yong.
Lee Hung Yong.
Yeah.
And her story is understood by any parent. She has two children, but little Lee came while mom was still stranded at home.
First you've had at home, I bet.
After being born at home, she was brought to Audubon Hospital by EMS. For all the blizzard babies, the stories of record-breaking days of snow and ice will be told and retold. But remember this about the world you entered. The white record-setting blanket that wraps us all can also be beautiful, turning a gray landscape into a white wonderland of fluff, framing it in crystal. Sleep tight. Many people have worked hard to make sure you're safe tonight. And our news director, Mike, and new mom, Sarah Roush, made it to the hospital in plenty of time for Haley's arrival. As for those who delivered elsewhere at home or on the way, we have no reports of any trouble for those children tonight.
And we have an update on another child, a 3-year-old girl we first told you about yesterday. It took a community effort to clear this parking lot at the Southeast Christian Church, and it was done so Michelle Schmidt could fly to Nebraska for a liver transplant. All is well tonight. Michelle had the operation early this morning, and she is doing great tonight. We were told she is already sitting up in bed and talking. We will keep track of Michelle's progress and let you know how she is doing, but her arrival in Nebraska, a triumph of the human spirit.
Certainly was.
Next in Kentuckiana, we are waiting for a warm-up. Chuck Taylor is the man with the forecast.
Also, we'll take you back in Sky 11 for a bird's-eye view of what Kentuckiana looks like.
Just Chuck Taylor, Ken Schultz, and Ashley Chisholm, the WHAS 11 Storm Team.
Well, with these low temperatures, we are going down lower than we have gone before.
That's right.
And ice on the Ohio River, you can really tell outside, people just frigid in this bitter cold.
But by this time tomorrow, we'll be coming out of the cold wave. That's the good news, and we're still talking about 50 degrees by next week. Well, let's talk about our coldest weather. The coldest we've ever had officially in Louisville is 20 below zero. We set that on two occasions. The last time was January 24th, 1963. There are some of the other cold readings. You can see 19 below in 1951, 16 below January 20th, 1985. And really, the last extremely cold weather we had around here was on December 22nd, 1989. The coldest temperature ever in Kentucky, 34 below in Cynthiana, in 1963. Well, we have record-breaking temperatures to show you right now. There's a record for Indianapolis, 20 below zero, a record in Cincinnati, 16 below, a record in Lexington, 14 below. Just about every temperature you see here is a record tonight, and temperatures are still going down. As we've pointed out from our storm team trackers, temperatures are already 20 to 21 below zero in some of the outlying areas of Kentuckiana. It is 12 below officially at the airport right now. The humidity is 78%. Winds have dropped off, so we're not talking much about a wind chill factor. The wind right now is 5 miles an hour, giving us a wind chill of 17 below. But with clear skies, calm winds, and a heavy snow cover, we're talking about radiational cooling, and that's why we're talking about possibly tying our all-time record here in Louisville. And just look how high the barometer is as that big Arctic high moves right over us now, 30.69 inches. We started out at midnight with a high of 3 degrees. Earlier this evening, it got down to 13 below zero, and we've had a trace of snowfall in some flurries early on. Well, all the big storm clouds have moved off the East Coast. We saw lots of sunshine today. Skies are clear right now. There is a disturbance out over the Rockies. You see those clouds will move rapidly in here during the day tomorrow, and it looks like we may see a little bit of snow tomorrow afternoon into tomorrow night. But there's the big weather maker, a huge Arctic high pressure system that originated right up over the North Pole, is moving right over the Ohio Valley right now. And now we can turn to the west and see this developing low pressure system out over the Rockies. It has very little moisture to work with. There is no precipitation associated with this system right now. On the other side of that, you find the warm weather in Los Angeles today, 82 degrees for a high. Well, during the day tomorrow, that little low will move eastward. We're going to see the clouds and a little bit of light snow starting tomorrow afternoon, continuing tomorrow night, ending as a few flurries on Thursday, and then our warm-up starts. So for tonight, there is a chance we could tie for our coldest temperature ever here in Louisville, minus 20. Then tomorrow, the light snow will move in during the afternoon. The high tomorrow, 8 above. Tomorrow night, we'll see light snow with an overnight low of 2 above. On Thursday, the snow will end. It looks like some areas will see light accumulations, maybe a half inch or so. A high of 18 on Thursday, 30 on Friday. And look at that, above freezing on Saturday, up to 38. Into the 40s on Sunday, and I think by Monday we could hit 50 degrees. Most of next week should be dry and warm.
And I guess we cannot stress enough how dangerous this cold can
absolutely.
Be if you're caught out in it, so do not venture out unless right. you absolutely have to. Thank you, Chuck.
Well, from Sky 11 today, we saw the second day of icy weather reflected through brilliant sunlight, and our helicopter flew through weather that was cold enough to start freezing on the Ohio River.
It's a little after 6 o'clock. And there is no rush to get home. Almost nobody has been to work. At Spaghetti Junction, the traffic is moving straight across the Kennedy Bridge to Indiana, where many roads are already clear. But the ramps from east and west in Kentucky are unused, and changes in elevation are impassable. A jackknife truck blocks the always dangerous off-ramp from I-65 toward Lexington. From the helicopter, the world is still a whiteout, with trucks stopped in single file. But today, for the first time, we see smaller vehicles passing by on places where the snowplows have been working. Traffic is moving again at Stanford Field as a solitary jet moves toward a takeoff into the clear sky. But mostly, from above, it's Kentuckiana in frozen animation. Little or no traffic in the neighborhoods. The sun sets on a downtown skyline that is lonely and mostly abandoned. Only a few are daring enough or able to travel downtown. And finally, the signs of the bitter cold. Steam rises off the Ohio River, and patches of ice begin to form along the shoreline. It is a city, a region in the icy grip of a tough winter, a winter that still has 2 months to run.
And Sky 11 returns tomorrow morning for continuous coverage of traffic and highway conditions on Good Morning Kentuckiana.
And coming up next here on the News Channel, a look at what's going on in the rest of the world tonight, including the latest from the earthquake and the aftermath in Los Angeles.
And here is a list that you have been waiting for tonight, the list of school closings accompanied by Chuck Mangione. Thank you.
We're heading into our seventh.
President Clinton goes to Southern California tomorrow to get a first-hand look at the earthquake damage. The pictures are spectacular. It looks like someone just cut this highway in two pieces. Police are urging people to stay home. It will take at least $100 million to repair the roads. 34 people have died, nearly half in this apartment building that collapsed. 20,000 people spent last night in campgrounds. They either have no power or no home. Many people who stayed outdoors say they feel safer than being inside.
I decided to come here because I didn't want anything, as you said, falling on my head, or, you know, my house was just a disaster. I couldn't handle being in there, you know.
Do you feel safer out in the open?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I feel like instead of like me being on the second floor jumping up and down, I'm down here and it just kind of in a gliding motion, not really as bad as it would be upstairs.
Many, many aftershocks out there. It could take a year for life to get back to normal in Southern California. People are still feeling the tremors tonight.
Today, authorities in Portland, Oregon got their chance to question the figure skater Tanya Harding about the assault on Nancy Kerrigan. Harding and the district attorney walked into his office for this meeting. Harding says she wants to clear her name and prove that she had nothing to do with the attack on Kerrigan. The district attorney won't say much about the investigation.
All I can say is that based on the evidence we have and the investigation that we're ongoing, we're not ruling anybody in or we're not ruling anybody out.
There was another new twist in this case today. Authorities reportedly have records that indicate that Harding's former husband used U.S. Olympic money given to Harding to pay for the attack on Kerrigan. Jeff Galluli denies he did anything wrong. Today, President Clinton lost another cabinet nominee, this time the man he wanted as Secretary of Defense. Bobby Inman changed his mind and withdrew from the confirmation process. Clinton wanted Inman to replace Les Aspin, but Inman says he doesn't like all of the attacks on his character and his reputation. The Republican leader, Bob Dole, said Inman probably wasn't qualified to be Defense Secretary. And Mr. Clinton received his first presidential physical today. And look at this. After the checkup, he came off the plane in bitter cold without a coat. Doctors say, though, he is in excellent health. The only things that doctors could find wrong with the president is a few allergies and a little higher cholesterol than is ideal. Coming up, Indiana in a Wild basketball game with Purdue tonight and the Wildcats in Gator Country.
And Danny Sullivan will chase the checkered flag in a different kind of car this season. And as we go to break here, we want to show you business closings that we have at this hour.
So much for cabin fever when you've got a Wildcat and a Hoosier basketball game on. They'd be home anyway, right?
Yeah, absolutely. We just wiped that cabin fever out tonight. Totally. ESPN couldn't have planned it any better. Huge amounts of snow keeping folks here in Kentuckiana indoors. So why not a Kentuckiana doubleheader on the tube? First up, Indiana at Purdue, Gene Cady with the ugliest haircut in college basketball, providing some sideline entertainment. And it is Damon Bailey to Allen Henderson in the second half. This game saw several lead changes. Henderson had 24 points on the night. Also for IU, Todd Lindemann was a factor on the inside. He has its first conference loss, 83-76. Now, moving 6 seconds left in this basketball game. Well, you remember this scene. Louisville's Danny Sullivan coming out of this 360 spin and going on to win the Indy 500 back in 1985. Well, Sullivan will now take his show to the NASCAR stock car circuit. He says he'll run in 5 Winston Cup events this year, including the inaugural Brickyard 400 on August 6th in Indianapolis. He'll join the Winston Cup circuit full-time in 1995. He's making the move after being dropped by his sponsor on the Indy circuit. Well, the Louisville IceHawks, the Partridge family thing, by the way, Danny Bonaducci won in a unanimous decision. He said he had no idea Osmond hit as hard as he does.
And we're going to show you that after a while, in just a few minutes.
Okay. Thanks, Gary.
And up next, final check of this bitter cold weather.
And is this the match of the year? Donnie and Marie versus the Partridge family in a knockdown dragout.
It's not anything remotely related to that, but it could be the boxing match of the year. If you watch television in the 1970s, take a look at these pictures. You may recognize these men in shorts. One of them is Donny Osmond of Donnie and Marie fame, and the other is Danny Bonaducci for the Partridge family. The two got mean in the boxing ring for a local charity, but the competition turned ugly. Danny won, Donnie lost. Danny Osmond's got a bloody nose and wasn't pleased with the judging. He wants a rematch.
The weather turned ugly here a couple of days ago, and Chuck tells us how ugly tonight.
Well, the cold is the ugly part tonight. It is 12 below right now. It has been as low as 13 below during the past few hours, setting a new record for today's date. And it looks like tomorrow we could tie for the coldest temperature ever officially here in Louisville, getting down to 20 below. Now, in outlying areas, it is already 20 below zero and could be as much as 25 below zero. Then tomorrow it starts to warm up, but we'll see a little bit of light snow coming in during the afternoon, a high of 8, snow tomorrow night, an overnight low of 2. Then the warm-up really starts by the weekend up above freezing.
And it will be welcomed. Yes. Thank you, Chuck.
Gary Fogle passes this along that UK has lost the game tonight. Florida beat UK 59-57. If you have to be out tomorrow, or even if you just want to get up early, then make sure to watch Good Morning Kentuckiana. We'll begin at 5:30 again tomorrow morning with live reports on all of the road conditions throughout Jefferson County and southern Indiana and all of Kentucky.
And do be careful. Take the cold very seriously. It is bitter out there. We'll be back tomorrow. See you then, everybody. Stay safe.
The prestigious Associated Press Awards.
First place WHAS, first place in newscast, first place in breaking spot story, first place in enterprise investigative reporting, first place in featured and first